Hey everyone, and welcome back to another innovative investment idea. My name is Dave, and in today's video, we'll be taking a look at the Alteryx Q2 2020 earnings report to try and figure out why the stock saw such a huge decline in price as a direct result. I'll be going through some of the data to see if a swift recovery is on the cards. But before we get started, just a friendly reminder to hit the like button at the end if you find the video useful, but also the subscribe button if you're new, as it really helps support the channel as we push for that elusive 1,000 subscriber. So with all that said, let's dive right in. After market close on August 6, 2020, Alteryx, ticker symbol Alpha Yankee X-Ray, released its earnings report to cap off a very challenging first half of the year, resulting in a vicious sell-off which saw the stock price tumble after hours for a total decline of 28% by the end of the next trading day, shedding almost a third of its value. It could be argued that the loss was unusually large given the stock's sterling track record to that point, but if we consider that cloud-based stocks in general also took a huge hit, with companies such as Fastly declining 12% and Datadog 16%, it seemed like many traders were simply taking a breather from the sector, and this exacerbated the negative sentiment, even if Alteryx wasn't specifically the target. The correction is certainly not the first of this magnitude that the stock has encountered, however, obviously in addition to the market-wide pandemic crash, as it also suffered a significant one almost a year to the date, when it dropped from roughly $147 a share in early September 2019 to just above $87 a share in late October, a 40% decline based on mostly valuation concerns. As we now know, it not only recovered from the dip some 3 to 4 months after the October low, but would go on to eclipse the previous September highs as well. But in any case, let's take a look at the Q2 results to try and figure out if the current decline was justified or if it was a classic case of severe overreaction by investors, which should result in an eventual return to form. I'll assume everyone is already familiar with my long-term thesis of the company, its core business, moat, and total addressable market, but if you're not, feel free to click on my previous analysis video of Alteryx, appearing as a card in the top right-hand corner now. While my opinion at the time was based on the financial results prior to this quarter, none of the underlying thesis has changed much despite the decline in price, factoring in the fallout of the pandemic. Okay, so starting with the investor presentation slide deck from Alteryx themselves, which I will link in the description if you're interested in checking out. The first thing that leaps off the page is the precedent the company had set with regards to its business cycle, consistently ramping up revenues from Q1 leading to a peak during Q4 each of the two previous years. Presumably, the biggest disappointment for investors and analysts alike is the Q2 revenue number of $96 million coming well under the $109 million for Q1, representing an actual 12% decline quarter over quarter. Obviously, when investing in growth companies, it's never great to see a decline in any metric except for net losses, especially at this early stage of development, but a few thoughts on this. Number 1, $96 million is still objectively a solid number and a figure that easily beats any reported amount from before the trailing 12 months. Additionally, it is even 17% higher than the corresponding revenue from Q2 2019, meaning that the company is definitely still growing at a fairly healthy rate on an annual basis. If we go back a few slides from the presentation and take a look at its customer base for a moment, what was actually a strength and diversity before the pandemic, since it was selling to customers across every industry, has now ironically become a weakness as it serves many customers in heavily affected segments. With no actual data pertaining to specific customer agreements or origin of revenue, I'm simply speculating, of course, but my guess is that the weakness in revenue for the quarter came from sectors such as retail, travel and hospitality, energy and utilities, financial services, and more than likely, food services, and potentially even media and entertainment, also not particularly thriving under the current conditions, with the exception of Netflix. So as an investor, you should assess your thoughts on whether you are generally bullish or bearish about the economy. Will it be quick to recover, and will a solution to the pandemic even be found? If you answered no to either of these questions, then a heavy sell-off was potentially justified, and you should even follow through on your conviction and probably short the entire market. But if you're an optimist like me, who believes that a solution is forthcoming, then clearly the aforementioned sectors should recover in time and lift Alteryx along with it, since it has already established relationships with all the companies pitched here, and its success is closely tied to theirs. The second thought about the numbers so far is that if we consider for a moment that is a cloud company operating under a software as a service or SaaS business model with a predictable $430 million annually recurring revenue, as we will see shortly, the company has already demonstrated and will more than likely continue increasing its baseline each and every year moving forward. The financial metric which attests to this is extremely solid 126% expansion rate. As a reminder, the expansion rate tells us how much existing customers are augmenting their spending through either add-ons, upsells, or cross-sells. So 126% means that existing customers are on average spending 26% more each year than the one prior. In fact, if we go forward one slide, we can see that the company has always managed to maintain a healthy expansion rate, although it does appear on the surface to be declining in recent quarters. But was this decline a factor in the sell-off as well, without investors taking into account that Alteryx has seen a similar decline in the past, only to have it ramp up again? This metric should closely be correlated to the first point I made, and that with any hint of a true economic recovery, the expansion rate should head north again. Advancing one more slide, we see that despite its challenges, Alteryx has continued to position itself well for the future by increasing its customer base 27% year over year to now over 6,700 companies. The rate of increase has been steady and seemingly unaffected by the pandemic at least, so there's no reason to believe that this, in conjunction with the expansion rate, won't contribute to significant revenues growth again in the future. The final thought on the decline in Q2 revenue is the uncoincidental decline in data science jobs. Although data analytics is generally a growing subsegment that I believe will become pivotal to business transformation in the medium to long-term future, in the short term, it is evidently not high on the list of priorities for many companies struggling through the economic downturn. In other words, companies are trying to maintain their current level of operations and trying to hit a reasonable level of profit despite the difficult climate, and are not actively spending money on new projects or initiatives such as improving their handling of data or overall efficiency, which is really what data analytics is about. In fact, as we can see from this article from July 30th, data science jobs have been amongst the worst hit during the pandemic. There's even been a marked decrease in tech job listings in general over the last few weeks of 36% when compared to the same period last year, but data scientist jobs are down an even more significant 43%. The worst hit job sectors are logically travel and tourism, which fell by over 70%, but even less affected than even tech, where jobs in supermarkets, which fell by 9% year over year, and government jobs only falling by 11% over the period. As we can see at the bottom of this article, the worst hit job subcategories within the tech sector have been data science and IT management jobs, the two roles that utilize and stand to benefit the most from companies looking to spend and expand into data analytics software such as Alteryx. So overall, the pandemic has proven to have been a significant headwind for Alteryx, much more than even analysts had anticipated coming into Q2, resulting in projections that were quite frankly too high to begin with. Remember that on Wall Street, while the actual financials don't always translate directly to movement in stock prices, the performance of a company relative to projections usually do. Obviously, the lack of revenue was seen as a big issue by investors, but at least we now have explored some of the plausible reasons for its decline, so let's now move on to the actual Q2 earnings report. As we've already covered, revenues for Q2 were $96 million, up 17% year over year, with the confirmed $430 million annually recurring revenue, which actually grew an extremely healthy 40% year over year. Assuming Alteryx does not suffer sudden customer turnover, this means it is guaranteed at least $430 million annually moving forward, even without any new sales or customers. The company does indeed highlight the significant effects of the pandemic, but reinforces its long-term growth story by continuing to invest heavily into R&D, even developing an entirely new category of software known as analytic process automation, and provided updates to its existing offerings. Again, the company appears to be setting up for significant growth once these investments begin to bear fruit, with the obvious trade-off being increased costs of operations in the short term, even resulting in a net loss, as we will look at very soon. Gross margins remain flat but strong at around 90%, which is not unusual for a software company with generally low cost of production per unit sold, so there isn't anything remarkable here that might have affected the drop in price. The next part, however, is where some additional concern might be had, in addition to the decline in revenue, which was increased GAAP losses from operations, leaping to $17.8 million when compared to $8.3 million the same period a year ago. Other companies like Uber, for example, have opted to slash jobs and cut costs to preserve capital in this climate, but Alteryx has clearly decided to push on in spite of the decline in revenues, choosing to instead ramp up R&D and generally maintain its high cost of operations. As we'll see shortly, it even launched a free data analytics training program called Adapt to thousands of workers globally, which could pay big dividends when those workers begin to seed their platform knowledge amongst their respective companies. Add all these factors together, and it's pretty obvious that the company should suffer a heavier loss than previous periods, particularly to its bottom line, which came in at negative 35.3 million compared to negative 3.2 million for the corresponding period a year ago, less than 10 times the amount. As a quick reminder, however, the company was actually profitable during 2018 and 2019 on an annual basis, generating roughly $28 million of net income in both years, so this huge loss is breaking away from the norm, which clearly led to shattered expectations. If you're a long-term investor in Alteryx like myself, I think giving up gratification today for a larger payoff tomorrow seems justifiable, but as every investor's time horizons are different, I leave that for you to decide. Cash flows remain flat, so there shouldn't have been much effect here either, and as we've already gone through most of the below highlights, I won't mention them again. But let's look at the financial outlook section, however. Revenue guidance for Q3 is between 111 and 115 million, so above Q1's relatively strong numbers. What's promising to see, though, is that non-GAAP income is expected to turn substantially positive again, somewhere in the range of 8 to 12 million, hinting that it could be returning to profitability again during Q4, even under GAAP. Full year comes in somewhere between 460 and 465 million overall, representing only a conservative increase of about 11% year over year. To provide further context, the increase in revenues between 2017 and 18 came in at 92%, and 2018 and 19 came in at 65%. So again, it's not hard to imagine why investors may have had such wildly unrealistic expectations despite the very different current market conditions today. So now, having reviewed both the investor presentation and its Q2 earnings report, while there is clearly some general revenue weakness and a net income result that doesn't live up to the usual Alteryx gold standard, I truly do believe that everything is justifiable and under control by management, so there isn't really anything that should reflect such a drastic 28% sell-off. If you think there is some detail that I've missed, or have some other material concern about Alteryx that does justify the decline, please let me know in the comments down below. So to close up the video, I want to quickly discuss two things. The first is the current analyst attitudes towards Alteryx as reported on MarketBeat. Clearly, not all recommendations have been updated since the Q2 earnings report, so these may shift drastically over the coming weeks. But as it stands, there are currently 9 buy ratings, 4 holds, and only 1 sell for an aggregate price target of $145, representing a 20% upside from the current price. If we skip ahead to the rating section down below, we see a flurry of analyst ratings have come in just after earnings. Oppenheimer reiterated a buy rating, and although it's not listed, should be $180. Piper Sandler, although lowered its price target from $195 to $185, still implies a significant upside to the current level. And Goldman Sachs has a street-high target of $216, which was issued only a month or so ago at the end of June. So again, full disclaimer, these might change soon given the latest earnings report, but overall, the analysts seem to agree that the stock was unfairly maligned. The last thing I want to bring up in this video is actually to take a look at AMD's trajectory, which might give us a little insight into what might be possible with Alteryx, as the entire scenario immediately reminded me of my investment into that company at the time. When AMD announced a disappointing Q3 2018 earnings result, where it grew by only a meager 4% year over year, and a projected worse than expected fourth quarter revenue of $1.45 billion, well below consensus estimates of $1.6 billion, it shed close to 25% of its value after hours and the following trading session. In fact, the slump had even been initiated slightly before the official report, with some analysts downgrading the stock, and the sell-off persisted for a few weeks afterwards, ultimately moving the price from a high of $33.60 on the 25th of September to as low as $16.17 on 30th of October, an overall decline of 52%. After having grown tremendously up until that point, and in fact it was actually one of the top performing stocks in the market during all of 2018, despite the huge decline towards the end, things were looking grim for AMD's future prospects. Some investors would have panicked and sold off the shares, while others may have written them off completely as a company that had seen its best days behind it. Now, I'm not suggesting that Alteryx will for sure follow the same path as AMD, but given the weakness in revenue for only a single quarter, weaker than expected guidance for the next quarter, and customers highly dependent on an economic rebound from the pandemic, there are certainly signs of weakness here, but ones that I believe can be overcome with patience and time given the strong foundation and product the company has built. Oh, and by the way, the price of AMD on August 6, 2020, just a few days ago? $84.85. That about wraps it up for this video. What are your thoughts on Alteryx and its earnings report? Have you become more or less bullish? Post them down below in addition to any other questions or comments. Also, don't forget to hit the like button if you enjoyed this video, and again, please consider subscribing to really support the channel if you haven't done so. Before I go, click on the top video here to take a look at the latest and greatest updates on Workhorse, an exciting electric vehicle manufacturer, or alternatively, down here, for a look at Lemonade, a company using artificial intelligence to disrupt the age-old insurance industry. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.